Welcome to the Cybersecurity Speaker Series, presented by NSA's Cybersecurity Collaboration Center. Our mission is to augment and amplify NSA's ability to prevent and eradicate threats to national security systems and the defense industrial base by establishing open, robust, and collaborative relationships across industry and government. Through bidirectional threat intelligence sharing and joint analytic tradecraft development, these partnerships leverage unique talents and capabilities to enhance cybersecurity across the nation. In this series, you'll hear about the work we do here and its real-world applications, bringing these insights to you through some of the top minds at NSA.
Welcome to the Speaker Series from NSA's Cybersecurity Collaboration Center. I'm Josiah Dykstra, a technical fellow here at NSA. In the Speaker Series, we invite NSA experts to come share their insights, their expertise, and their knowledge about cybersecurity and their contributions to this field. My guest today is Randy Resnick, a strategic lead for Zero Trust here at NSA, and Zero Trust is our topic for the day. Randy, thanks for being with me.
Nice to be here.
Looks like you got the memo about the blue shirt today.
It looks like we went to the same store. Yes.
Well, thank you again for being here. I think a good place to start is with an overview of Zero Trust. Either people know a lot about it, but for those who might not be familiar, what is Zero Trust?
Yeah, Zero Trust is a really popular subject these days in cybersecurity. What Zero Trust is a way of rethinking cyber strategy. It's a framework that makes you think about the security of the network, assuming breach has already occurred, meaning the adversary is already in the network. That premise alone causes you to rethink the architecture of how to design a network. Networks of today don't have a design with the breach mentality. Also, it's very data-centric. Zero Trust doesn't necessarily care about the IT portion. They see it as transport. What really matters is your data, your valuable data, where it originates, how it travels through the network, and where it is stored. Zero Trust also is based on least privilege that's enforced, meaning you're only allowed to see as much as you're allowed to see, no more, no less. Validating the users and authorizing users and devices is another key element of Zero Trust. And when you put all that together, it creates an effect that is extremely powerful that existing networks today don't have. And that's why everybody seems to be very attracted to Zero Trust, and that's why NSA is very interested in Zero Trust, because it appears to be a really strong cybersecurity model going forward to address the advanced persistent threats that we face today.
Yeah, it's very clear that NSA cares a lot about this, since you have a title that reflects that need. Yeah. Is there any more you can tell us about what is NSA doing in this space?
Sure. So NSA has the responsibility and the mission to help secure the Department of Defense and national security systems. As part of that, it also includes the defense industrial base. So anything that is carrying confidential or classified information, anything that's sensitive, is NSA's realm to aid and help and guide that customer, those customers, in securing their networks. All the customers to this point have what I would call legacy networks that have many cybersecurity solutions layered on them, and all of them now want to go to a Zero Trust architecture. Can't do everything at once, so we have to prioritize. But that's where NSA comes in. NSA is building up a staff and expertise and the guidance documentation to allow that fairly quick modernization to occur.
Zero Trust has been around for quite some time, I think. Why is it coming back into popularity, or why is it especially hot and needed right now?
Yeah, so Zero Trust as a idea came about in around the year 2010 with Forrester Research. A researcher by the name of John Kindervag is the one that originated it. At that time in 2010, which is not that long ago, it's only been 11 years ago, the technology to do it wasn't available. It was a theory. Since that theory, there have been many companies that have started to develop capability in their product lines to actually put together rudimentary zero trust capability. And every single year, it seems like there's an explosion in the field on adding more and more vendors that have this capability to put it all together. The Department of Defense got very interested in it in January 2019, and we've been persistent in it and very focused on it ever since then.
I bet you've learned a lot even in that short amount of time.
Tremendous amount.
In those conversations, what are some myths or misconceptions about Zero Trust that you can help correct for us?
So a lot of people, when they think about Zero Trust, they think it is an item you could buy off the shelf, install it, and you're done. It's quite the opposite. It's a bunch of capabilities that need to be integrated together to create that effect. It's not something that happens quickly. It can't be overused to say that it's a journey. Sometimes that journey, depending on resources, could take years. So NSA has come up with a idea of crawl, walk, run, where you start off slow, you do simplistic things first, and as you get them accomplished, you then go to the more sophisticated zero trust capabilities. So it's not a race, it's about securing your data, understanding your users, understanding your devices, understanding your data flows, laying down the right policies and procedures within the network, and integrating them all together. And that essentially is the ingredients for Zero Trust.
I think that's a nice analogy that you can start very small. It doesn't have to be all in from the beginning.
Right.
So I like that a lot.
Right.
Say a little bit more about that crawl phase, because there's probably people who might be convinced to give something a try without sort of going all the way in. How would they start?
So an easy way to think about crawl is to understand your data flows. Where is your data? Believe it or not, there's a lot of owners out there that don't exactly know where their data exists. Is it in the cloud? Is it in an on-prem server? Is it elsewhere? You really need to understand where your data sits, because that keys in on whether or not it's encrypted or not. Where does it originate from? That's point one. Point two is know your network. Who exactly is on your network? Who is supposed to be on your network? Is somebody from 4 years ago that went on to get another job removed from accessing your network? If you have an Active Directory type of architecture, did you remove this person from Active Directory? So Active Directories age and they need to be kept up to date. That's a vulnerability that can be taken advantage of if Active Directories are not kept up to date, because then I could pose as a user that's not there and the system thinks I'm legitimate. So know your users and validate your users. Also, you need to understand your devices that you're allowing on the network. Not every device should be allowed on your network. You should only be enrolling devices that you want on your network. So it's the combination of who you want access to your network by the user, what devices you want on the network. You also need to look at the applications that you have on the network. Some of these applications are ages and ages old. If you're not using an application for mission, it should be removed. And so the dynamic between users, devices, applications, and the data is really the low-hanging fruit that could easily be done with relatively little cost to start you off on that crawl phase for Zero Trust.
Okay, that's great. You've done a nice job of describing the sort of IT backend part of this. Tell me about the user side. I think users might be skeptical that this will be more security that gets in their way. What's the experience like for them?
Yeah, that's a great question. So from a user perspective, the bandwidth is increasing. The response time to the network is increasing. So when we put down zero trust capability on the network, from the user's perspective, if anything, they see either no change or they see actually change that speeds up the network. Because while they're doing the zero trust implementation, they're also upgrading the network behind the scenes at the same time. It's considered a modernization effort. That being said, what they may see in a physical way is the way they sign on to the network. Right now, they may sign on with a name and a password. Zero Trust is enforcing multi-factor authentication.
Sure.
meaning two or more factors of authentication. So you may see the need for something you know, like a password, and something you have, like a hardware device, a YubiKey, you name your system, and the two have to be with you in order to get access to that network. And it's a strong recommendation as part of the reference architectures for both the DoD and also the NSS and the Defense Industrial Base, that they all move towards multi-factor authentication sign-on environment.
I think users will be comforted that not only do they get better security, but it is easy to use. It is very usable. They'll appreciate that a lot.
It's not anything that the user should fear. Just let it happen. The security behind it is strong. It's stronger than what they see today. From a system administrator point of view or from the defender's point of view, they're going to find it easier to defend because the noise floor, all that other stuff that's happening today won't be seen because by default, most things are not allowed to talk to other things. So the noise level in the network will be eliminated. So what they will see is actually real traffic that perhaps should be analyzed.
That's very positive. If there's one thing you wanted the audience to take away about Zero Trust, what would it be?
Don't fear it. Embrace it. It's something that everybody is moving towards. It's a good thing for cybersecurity. It's a good thing for cybersecurity professionals to understand how to implement. Architectures are going to change, but the overall benefit of Zero Trust is so vast that we may actually see less and less cyber incidents in the news that we see today compared to what we may see 5 years from now.
So let's talk about those choices. If somebody is interested in this but doesn't maybe want to jump all in today, how can they get started? What's the right way there?
So NSA produced in February 2021 a cybersecurity information sheet, publicized it on NSA.gov. I believe, 7 pages of really good information on how to implement Zero Trust and best practices and really defining what Zero Trust is and how it could benefit users at all sizes, from small companies all the way up to big enterprises.
Well, Randy, thank you for being here. Thank you for sharing a bit about Zero Trust and dispelling some myths that we've heard along the way. Thank you for tuning in today. Please be sure to watch our Twitter account at NSA Cyber for the announcement of future episodes. See you next time.